When we were kids, we had a kind of toy referred to as the Chinese trap or Chinese handcuffs. They were made of flexible strips of bamboo, cylindrically fashioned, and when placed on opposing fingers, pull as you might, they got tighter, and you became even more stuck than before. The only way to extricate yourself from them was to move your fingers counterintuitively deeper into the cylinders, going with the snare, and there you began the process of getting out. This is an essential lesson about not getting stuck. Go with the energy. Roll with the flow of the opposition. Do not resist. Trap. America is the best country in the world, my father announced in the family room one evening when, unusually, no other members of the household were present. The television, typically on, was squeezing itself quickly and loudly from channel to channel under the stereotyped cadence of Joe's independently functioning thumb on the 1973 incarnation of remote control technology. I cautiously took my eyes from the screen, where David Carradine, playing Kwai Chang Kane, was mouthing Asian axioms in an episode of Kung Fu, to glance over at my father, knowing full well that he would only compose such a mindless non sequitur because he could no longer endure the anxiety of being in the room alone with me. A 24-year-old son he could not relate to, was concerned about, angry at, a little fearful of, repelled by, and whose hair length was constitutionally beyond his capacity to tolerate. I was not his kind of guy. And all the wisdom of the Tao Te Ching or Confucius, the collective skill of all the writers of the Kung Fu television drama, was not enough to distract him from his discomfort. You got a long neck, you know that? He mentioned as an addendum to his initial patriotic proclamation. Well, we grow 'em lanky here in the USA, Pop, I said, blindly building up to take the bait. As always, and again. It's been said that humans are the only animals who participate in building, baiting, and setting up traps, and then, as if without any recollection of having done so, proceed to step boldly into them. My mother was out with one of my brothers. She was off, and as usual, lying about visiting with her sister and her three nieces, all in an unconscious but apparently purposeful effort to proceed outside of my father's awareness with my brother's insidious development. Another brother was at boarding school, most likely alternately drinking and sleeping at the time. My sister was selling snake oil in the dark somewhere, saving up to reach her goal of leaving home to become an unrecognizable and essentially missing person one day. Success achieved. I was just home from college to Lexington, Mass. For a visit and another installment of conversational trap building. But still hoping to feel the sense of deep rest I remembered in his warm arms when I was frightened or sick, it seemed not so many years before, but lifetimes. America! The best, he said emphatically. Pop, help me understand the connection between the length of my neck and the national anthem you're getting ready to sing. Never mind that. It should stay the way it is, your neck. If it were shorter like mine, not long like your mother's, your hair would be even farther down your back.
Almost cut my hair.
Hey, Pop, I'm not cutting it, so why don't you just leave it alone? Everybody's laughing behind your back. You look ridiculous, he said, revving himself up. Oh, here we go. Another off-Broadway performance of hair. Oh, it's fine. It's fine, he said. Be whatever you want to be. Cool man, cool. That's you. And this is America. They let you do your thing. So do your thing, cool man. Okay, now tell me, what's a better country than America?
I don't know, Pop.
Holland? Holland. Holland? What are you, insane? Why'd you say Holland? Holland is nothing. Forget about it. There's no country like America. But at least you could have said something normal like England. No, he says Holland.
All right.
How about Canada? I said, attempting something normal. Canada? They don't exist without us. Number one, there's nobody up there. Number two, they're 30 years behind. Number three, it's freezing. Number four, Russia would own it if it wasn't for us, all right? Okay. France, Paris, France. How's that for a great place? France. N-O-T-H-I-N-G. Nothing. The Nazis walked in, sat down, started eating cheese and knocking up all the girls, all right? What did the Frenchmen do? They waited for us. That's what they did. So forget about all those other shoemaker countries. Do you or do you not agree America's the best? Hey, Pop, it's your world. I'm just living in it. What the hell's that supposed to mean, Mr. Holland? All right, get on with it. Say what you're going to say. Okay, so we agree America is number one by far. Now, when you're talking about America, are we referring to the South? No, all dummies living in another world, waving some other flag. The Midwest? Cows, corn, nothing. Those northern states over there? No. Freezing, useless, almost as bad as Canada. No, we're talking about the East and West Coasts, period. Now, the West Coast, forget about it. All there really is California. Too screwed up, Hollywood, fake, all glamour, movie stars and money and divorce and weirdos, plus crazy weather, and it's falling into the ocean anyway. So no on the West Coast. It's the East Coast. And when I say the East Coast, what am I talking about? Florida, Georgia? No, nothing. Old people and alligators over there, and you're bound to die one way or the other. See, we're talking about the Northeast Coast. New England, really. And when you're talking about New England, what are you talking about? Maine? Please, zero. Again, dummies, poor, freezing, nothing. Go for a few weeks in the summer if you can't afford the Cape, and then leave it with the broke and the frozen. Nice, Pop. Real nice. You're moving kind of fast here, don't you think? What? He says, continuing his wicked roll. What? New Hampshire? Even worse than Maine. At least Maine has some fake class. New Hampshire? Nothing. Fat women and men in checkered shirts and dirty hats with beards trying to get away with something. Taxes. State tax. No class, New Hampshire. Rhode Island? Crooks. Too small anyway, but it's run by the mob. And it's worth nothing to anybody but the wise guys, Rhode Island. Okay, then, what about Connecticut, I offer, as I just begin coming out of my stupor and get a first glimpse of the killing fields. Well, Connecticut has some class, more than Maine and New Hampshire, and a lot less dangerous than Rhode Island. But again, it's small, and it's too close to the South, he said, stretching for a point. He didn't have. Yeah, it's closer, Pop, that's true. But it's still a long way from the South, I said, now playing along. I mean, it's still New England, and it's not slipping away like California. So what? No matter. Connecticut cannot compare with Massachusetts, he said emphatically. He was feeling strong when he reiterated, there is no state like Massachusetts. New England, the best part of America. Massachusetts, the best state in the best part of America. Am I right or am I right? Well, you're right, I guess, I said, feigning acquiescence, using kung fu inspired by the TV show flickering before us. The circular attack, going with the flow of your opponent's energy, giving in to get your way. All that Kwai Chang Kane business. Tung Fu. easier to ride the camel in the direction he's going. And so he went on with a renewed sense of infallibility, the kind which drives the foolproof hurtling headlong toward destruction. Now, when you're talking about Massachusetts, what do you think you're talking about? Western Mass? Springfield? Come on. Poverty, drugs, crime. Who even knows where it is? And what? When you're talking about the Commonwealth, you think you're talking about Worcester? The armpit of the state? Same old guys running it into the ground for 100 years. Worcester is not what Massachusetts is about. The only thing Worcester and Springfield have going for them is that they're in Massachusetts, period. He reviews. Okay, so what do we got? America, the best country. Massachusetts, the best state. And the best state really comes down to Boston. Boston, best schools, best hospitals, best history. It's really Boston and the surrounding towns. Actually, inside the Route 128 belt. Now here, I knew that I had him. This was the trap Joe was going to step into. I could feel it. I knew it. I had come of age now, and the hunter became the hunted. Yeah, Poppy, you're right. It is the greater Boston area when you really think about it. Surrounding towns, the 128 belt, that's where it's all happening. See? He replied, barely believing his good fortune to have me in a correlative place. This is what I'm saying. No, I'm with you, I shot back, establishing him in the mouth of the wolf. And if you think about it, I went on, those towns, I mean, there's a few good ones, but Lexington has to be on the list of the best, right? Absolutely, he said. A case could be made by some that it is the best. Yes, I echoed. A case could be made. He vigorously nodded. Why not the best? He mused rhetorically. Best school system, beautiful town, Revolutionary War right here, close to Boston, no crime, nice people. Then he punctuated his list with, a case could be made. Righto, I said. A case could be made. This line had become my tripwire, my hook, the linchpin of the snare. I had him in a flow, and there was no way he could turn back now. I know. I spent years in those traps. Ones such as, you want to be smart or you want to be stupid? I want to be smart, Daddy. Okay, then, if you want to be smart, do what I tell you. You want to be stupid, do whatever you want. So, still wanting to be smart, I continued with what Daddy was telling me. When you look at Lexington, I remarked, how many neighborhoods do you think are the best? 2? 3? Monroe Hill? Merriam Hill? And right here, Cary Estates. Now, our neighborhood, being one of the best in town, was patently untrue, but he was in thrall, in a trance of narcissistic bliss. Is it not true? I asked like Clarence Darrow, leading the witness to craft his own demise. Certainly, he chimed in on cue. Yes, this is one of the best neighborhoods in Lexington, I echoed. I gestured him into a chorus of, a case could be made. And we would have chuckled if it weren't for the gravity of the matter under discussion. By now, the buttons on the remote control had long been still, the volume lowered. David Carradine was strapping the series of mysterious bags over his shoulders and heading off barefoot toward the setting sun of the western plains. So, if this is one of the best neighborhoods in one of the best towns, who has one of the best houses in this neighborhood? I queried. We do, he shouted entranced. Yes, we do, I said hypnotically. I delayed, savoring the moment, allowing him to sink back into his slack-jawed fantasy of final and ultimate prominence, until he was once again glazed over, the beads of his internal abacus stacking up just right. I waiting patiently for dramatic effect, and as if in afterthought said, "Hey, Pop." "Yeah?" he replied, eager for another proof of celebrity and distinction.
"It just came to me."
"What?" he asked with rapt and exhilarated attention.
"And I'm thinking here that quite possibly, even probably, we could be sitting in the very best spot in the world."
He was motionless, still trapped in the glare of some just darkening limelight. I took the lag to go on. "This family room right here is the epicenter of the universe, and you and I are in it.
Best place in the world. Who knew?"
Though his body arched up from its chair-bound slump in agreement, at the same time his facial expression had the look of a new dawn breaking, and he heard the spring let go and the jaws come crashing down. He looked at me half stunned and uttered, "Are you?" pointing his finger at me, and made a sound that trap things make from deep inside when they know what's happened. I smiled. He twisted his mouth into a wry, sideways grin. "You know, mister, there's no sense talking to you." And at that moment, he knew, like it or not, I was his son. I had him. I had arrived. I might not have been his type of guy, but he had to give me my propers. Right there, he softened, surrendered to the success of the deception I'd crafted. And in that moment, I knew that maybe, just a little, and perhaps against his will, he liked me.